My name's Jill Tisbury, and today we're going to be painting this beautiful Scottish wildcat in pastel on velour. Before we get started, I just want to talk a little bit about the materials that we're going to use. So the materials that we're going to use will be a mixture of stick pastels and pencil pastels. So the difference between the two, as you can probably see there, is that you've got a nice big tube of colour, and these are very soft. So the binder and pigment ratios are different in stick pastels than they are in pencil pastels. These tend to be harder, these tend to be softer. And if you are working on velour, you get some lovely coverage if you use stick pastels to put your base colours in. When you want to use detail, or when you want to create detail, use pencil pastels because they're harder and they will give you, as you can probably see here, a much finer point. That finer point stays there before it wears down. Okay, so we're ready to get started. So glasses on, and when you look at the picture that we've got here, you'll see that I've done a certain amount of work already. So we've done the background. We've got a nice diffuse background in there, which gives us a nice edge for us to work onto when we come to do the fur. Just have a little look at this reference image that we've got here. Just make sure you can see that okay. There's a number of things that we're going to be working on today, because we're going to look at how we create fur and how we create texture in that fur. So when you look at this wildcat, you can see that they've got lots of different types of texture in here. So you've got the short, almost stubbly like texture that you'll find around the nose, slightly longer on the muzzle, but sticky out in all sorts of places, whereas this nose is all going in one direction. You then come on to the slightly longer hair, so the most of the body is this sort of medium length hair. And the interesting thing here is that a wildcat, a Scottish wildcat, is what's called a true fur animal. And what that means is that they have a dense, almost matted felt-like undercoat under this. So it's like our undergarments really. It keeps her really nice and warm, and it makes it nice and toasty when she's out in the snow. But on top of that, she's got this layer of, you can probably just about see them here all over the place, all different directions. They're called guard hairs, and they stop the water going down into the fur. So when you're going to create this, you're going to lay a base colour, so like a map of the colours on the face, if you like. And we're going to lay that base colour with stick pastels. And on top of it, we're then going to work this texture in. And then the final layer on top of that will be these tiny guard hairs. So three layers, really. A base colour, a mid layer of texture, and then the top layer, which is the detail layer or the finishing layer. And that's where you put all of these sort of hairs in the ears, all of the whiskers. Really tempting to do the whiskers first, but it should be the very last thing that you do. So that's what we're going to go and see how we do that now. Let's put this back up here. Okay, so we look at this and you see we've got the background. What I've also done on the cat here is laid in all the darkest darks. So I've done that with a pastel pencil. The Caran d'Ache pastel pencils tend to be the softest of the pencils, while the pastels, the Faber-Castell pit pastels, tend to be pretty hard, pretty solid points, so you can get some really nice fine details on there. So I've used those to lay in this darkest of darks, really. And now I'm ready to move on to my stick pastels to get this base layer of colour that we talked about. Okay. So I'm going to start with a few different pastel colours. So the ones that I'm going to probably use the most of are the sepia set of colours. So you tend to get
stick pastels in tints. Tint one would be the lightest, and in this case, this goes all the way down, the sepia brown goes all the way down to tint five in the set that I've got here, which is quite a dark dark one. So I think I've got tint three here that I'm using at the moment, and I'm just going to go in and look at my reference image and check where the different layers of colour actually are. So under the eyes you've got quite a dark patch here, so you're all the while looking at your reference image. Don't worry that it's just no detail at all. In this layer you're not looking for detail, you're just looking for some coverage of colour. So I'm gonna use these darkest areas first. So usually where you've got this black layer here, you're going to have a blend out to dark just on the edges. I'm just moving the dust off that, and down at the bottom she's got some quite dark elements. Then around the ears, where you've got those little dark shadowy bits on the ears, just around the edge there. This might look a little bit too dark, but you might also hear me talk about colour space. So quite often people look at the images, and especially when you look at something like the muzzle here, and you think, well, that's white, so I'm going to paint that in white. And if you paint that in white, you've got a slight problem, because when it comes to actually putting any white detail on top of that, you've got nowhere to go. So I call this colour space. You need to give yourself space to put the lighter details on top. Bit like the ear on here. So these dark areas in the middle are the bits that I'm laying in at the moment. When we put the next layer on, it'll lighten up, because we'll add all these little light hairs on there. So that's what I mean when I talk about colour space. You just got to watch out for that, that you don't go too light too soon. This might look dark, but it'll work out in the end. And again, it starts to look patchy. I think a lot of painters talk about paintings going through an ugly stage. Especially in oil paintings, I know that quite often they go through an ugly stage. You sometimes get that with pastels as well, where you've got patchy paint, patchy colour all over the place. And then when you start to blend it with the light colours and put the next layers on, suddenly you've actually got something that looks pretty good. So I'm working from dark to light here. I've put all my darks in. I'm just going to the next darkest colour. So just around the edge. You might notice also, when I'm laying these colours in, they're small little strokes, but I'm generally going in the direction of the fur. I know there's no detail here at the moment, but I still want to make sure that when I lay the marks on there, I'm going the same direction that the fur's going in, where I possibly can. You also find you can either use the edge to get a sharp edge, or you can use the flat of your pastel if you want to layer a big sweep of colour in. So this down here, for instance, you can see on my reference here that there's a almost a sort of darkish patch coming down from this area here. So I'm just going to use the edge of that and lightly stroking down onto the velour. Okay, now under the mouth there's also, and again when I do this you might think this is a bit vicious, but there's also this layer of darker colour. And again, I'm not too worried that it's too dark, because this will lighten up when I start talking about the next layer and I start putting the next layer on. So just there, just gonna use my pencil because it's a sharper point, just so I don't lose these darks that are down here. Just pop those back in. And that's the whole reason I put the darks in to begin with, is that you tend to lose them sometimes if they're just pencil marks, because I drew this with graphite pencil when I started. Just take a step back, have a look, see if there's any other areas. I think I'm probably there with that colour for now. Maybe a little bit down here, so maybe we'll just give that quite a dark background here. And right round the edge. Okay, so that's that mid-brown. And again, if you get too dusty, it's quite handy to have some baby wipes. Just get rid of the dust on your hands. Just make sure that they're nice and dry before you start again on your velour. Okay, so this is the next tint up. You can see it's almost like we're filling the holes that we left with those dark areas. Just sit back every now and again, have a look, see if you've missed any areas, see if the colour's looking about right. And again, you can adjust any of the colours that we've got when we put the next layer in. But we're just laying this base to work on at the moment.
Okay, so we've got a base layer of colour in, looks really ugly at the moment, but the next step is for us to do that second layer where we can start adding a little bit of texture detail into the fur. Before I do that, I'm going to start with the nose, but I'm going to give her an actual nose right on the end there, so that I'll come back to this and give her a bit more detail on this nose. But the reason I'm doing this, oh, where's my black? Here we go. The reason I'm doing this is because when I actually start to work on this area of texture, some of the hairs, albeit minutely, come over onto the actual nose. So I don't want to be doing that afterwards. Now, you might notice here, if you can see this really closely, this is a really, really sharp pastel black. It's one of the few times that I actually use an outright black on this. But this is this area here is just where the opening for the nostril is, and it is really black. And I went over it the first time, you can see how it got lost, and I'm doing it again. But can you see that I'm pushing away? So you possibly just hear that. I'm just flicking that backwards, and you can see the real darkness that I'm getting on that edge there. Now that edge stops about here, and in fact blends out a little bit. So again, I'm using a grey, And that just starts to blend that top out a little bit. But all of this is in preparation for adding this detail around this muzzle. Because when we start to work here, you can see on the reference image that this just has this greyish tinge. So I'm flicking it backwards. What I'm doing, if it's exaggerated, is pushing into the paper and flicking backwards. So I'm pushing in, flicking backwards. And that is A, going to give me the depth where I want it, where I'm digging into the paper, and tail off. So it's almost like a flick of colour out. You can start to see that we're adding just enough there to give us that little shading that we've got. And she actually got shading on her nose as well. So once we've finished all of this, we can come back in here and sort of add that form to that nose. But I'll do that in a little while because we want to look at this texture on the fur. So again, a few more dots of colour in there. Few more dots of black, and I'm just dotting it in here because this fur here is the shortest fur that we'll find on the cat. So again, there's some flecks of black. I'm going to put them in to begin with, and we might lose them, but at least I know where they are for now, and we'll come back and work on that. So I've moved to Caran d'Ache pencils again because I mentioned they're soft, they're really soft, and I want some soft colour on here. I will go over the top of this again in the next layer to add some even more sharper detail. But these don't tend to have colours, but this is a sort of, what would you call that? A tan colour that we are going to use to try and get this tan depth on the nose. And again, I'm kind of mixing it on the page here. You can see it's lovely colour when we actually lay it on the page. Not too much because it's quite intense. And remembering that she's got a sort of, if we were going to draw this, it would be a little tube, a little cigar shape here of a nose that she's got. So on the top here, she got, where the light's catching it, some quite intense colour. And then just on the edge, she's got some colour. So I'm working back up the nose. I've gone back to a mixture of Caran d'Ache and Pitt pastels because where that light is hitting the side and the edge, you can see that you've got this sheen as it goes around the corner and on the top. And I'm working in very, very short little marks on here because it's short fur. So again, we gave ourselves this base colour that we can work into. And again, I'm pushing upwards. You can start to see that we're getting a little bit more texture now. I usually end up with a fistful of pencils when I do this because I'm kind of mixing these colours on the page. Always looking at the direction of the fur and always working in the direction of the fur. So I'm going to go ahead and do all of this short fur around the muzzle and then we'll talk about the medium length of fur and see how we create that. Okay, so I've done the second layer and you can see there's more texture now in this part of the picture. The thing here is the eye's black and white at the moment, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to finish the eye before we do the third layer of texture. And the reason for that is because there's quite a bit of colour in that eye and I just want to see how that relates to the colour around this. So I'm just going to finish the eye and then we'll do the third layer of texture in the fur.
Okay, so before we do this final third layer of detail on top of this texture coat that we've done, I've just given a little bit of colour to the eye because that will give me a better understanding of how the colours work together around the eye, the textures around the eye. So I'm going to go ahead now and do the third layer of detail on the fur. Okay, so I've just blended that out a little bit. This layer is all about putting the depth back into it, if you like, the detail into it. So you can see that this looks quite diffused at the moment, but as soon as I start to pull out this detail, these darks against the light, then we start to get the 3D look and feel to the fur. And I'll alternate between darks and lights here. You can see we're getting quite sharp, so I'm not blending these at all. I want these marks to be quite defined. And this is really all about working the contrast between the darks and lights. So I'm swapping here between my tiny, this is actually a Derwent pencil, but it's one of my favourite colours. It's a chocolate brown, and you can see I use it a lot because it's only that big. So there's the chocolate brown, there's the very, very light cream, and there's a sort of mid brown, sepia brown that we've got here. I've also got a black, and I've also got something slightly on the ochre side to blend any of those mid-tones in. So just down here you can see a little bit of ochre around the eye, just coming down to the bottom. Blending into that. This is quite a light. You see what I mean by giving yourself space to work, because we've got that deep colour underneath. When I put the light on, we get a really contrasty zing as the light goes on top of the dark there. And again, it's good to have these really soft pencils along with the hard pencils. So the soft Caran d'Ache allow you to put a lovely creamy soft layer on top of those darks. I'm working out from the eye, just on this bit. Now all of these colours that we are using here, people always ask me, what colour are you using when I'm doing stuff like this? I'm going to list it at the end. It's a lot easier than just talking through the colours as we go. And again, when I teach this on my courses, people get to have a play with all these different types of pastels, all of the stick pastels and all of the pencil pastels in all of the sort of ranges, which is quite useful because what I favour might not be the kind of thing that you like depending on your style. I'm just going to stick back up the top here just to show you on the bit that I've done, because I could go a little bit too far down. I don't want to do that. I'm just going to push that back a little bit. Right, so back into these. And again, you remember I said earlier on that velour takes lots and lots and lots of layers before it becomes saturated, which is great, really, because it means you can go layer on layer on layer, and the more layers you put on, the more depth you're going to create. So again, these are short hairs around this little bit, so these are short stabby motions that I'm making here. you can start to see that this is really coming alive around here. I'm twisting the pencil as I'm going as well on this bit, just to try and keep that sharpish point for a little bit longer. If you keep going on one side, obviously it's just going to flatten down on one side. Now this is almost, not quite, but almost the classic M that you get on tabby cats. Obviously this is a Scottish wildcat, so it's a proper wildcat rather than a domestic cat. But they all tend to, any kind of tabby cat like this, tends to have these M sort of look in these markings. I'm just strengthening these markings as I go, because as you work into these layers, the dust settles on top and you tend to lose some of the contrast. So it's all about strengthening up these colours as you go. Now at this stage you might be tempted to put the eyebrows in. If you look, she's got quite distinctive eyebrows on here. Just don't do it, because you've got more to do up here and you'll find that you'll lose the eyebrows as you go. So absolutely no point in doing that. But what I am going to do is just add a couple of flecks of white into this bottom bit here, just to lighten that up a bit. Allow me to blend in some of this dark. You can start now to see that this is really, as opposed to this, which is quite dull and subdued, this is starting to come forward and it's starting to come alive. So this is all about this tiny bit of detail that we're looking at. A subtle mixture of colours here. Now I mentioned a while ago about giving yourself colour space to work, and again here is a good example of that, because I used a cream, which I think was this one, and you can see if I put the two together we've got a big difference there. So I've got the cream as the base on that second layer. I'm now going to work over the top just ever so slightly with a few flecks of this white for the longer hairs that are on the top of here. And you can see that I can see them rather than them blending into the background. And if I just go in with some darks next to them, that'll push them out even more. So that gives me that nice blend of those slightly longer hairs on top. Again, I can use my white here, and I'm definitely not going to come back to this bit. And these don't all go in the right direction, these hairs on the ear. It's quite fluffy as well, so it does actually have quite a tuft of fur on that bit. Now, in the very, very final layer, What I will do here is go over the longer little flecks of hair that she's got on here with a watercolour pencil, because that's the only way I'm going to get them really, really, really fine. So I should probably do that with a watercolour pencil when I've finished. But again, this is just the separate out those colours. So I'm going to go ahead and finish all of this top part now, and then we can look at the longer hairs on that ear.
Okay, I think we're finished on that second layer. I'm starting to put some individual hairs in place, so that tells me that I'm ready to do the detail layer on this. You can keep going with more layers of texture. The more marks you put on there, the more depth you're going to get. But for now, I think we're good, and I think we're ready to move to this final layer, the third layer, where we're going to start on individual hairs, and we get to do the whiskers at this stage as well. Okay, so you can see that we finished our second layer. Just a quick recap on what we did here. You have lots and lots of different lengths of fur on this particular wildcat. So this part around here is quite distinctive. You can see it's got the dark areas in there. What we do want to do is flick up some of these white hairs, and you can see that I'm now going in all sorts of directions on top of this. It's slightly longer hair. Where we've got this ridge here, we're just going to put them a little bit closer together to create a more dense colour, that sort of cream colour that's on there, which looks fine. Maybe just a little bit down here. All I'm doing, you can probably hear by the noise, I'm stabbing it fairly hard, so I'm almost doing that kind of movement. And the closer together, the more dense the colour. Where we've got areas that are not so dense in colour, obviously that I'm spacing the marks out a little bit. And they're going in all sorts of directions, because if you look at the reference image, you'll actually see, just up here, you'll actually see that in this area, these marks go up here, and these are sort of all over the place, really. So a bit of a mishmash, but you can still see that dark area underneath. So if I come back down to my drawing here, I'm keeping them reasonably short here, but you can see that because I gave myself that colour space that we talked about, the dark area underneath, it's now looking more 3D than it was before. So I've got that depth underneath. Okay, so if we find that once we've done that, there's perhaps a few dark spaces missing, I'm going to use a sepia. This is a De La Rowney sepia. It's my favourite sepia because it's dark, but it's not black. It just gives you a nice rich colour. I'm just going to flick some of those dark patches that have perhaps been lost back in there. And that's it. Good to go. Now, obviously, a lot of people think about velour, and there's a lot of rumours around that the pastel falls off velour. You can see that I'm working on this and my hands are reasonably clean, but it still tends to dull some of the colours if you're working in that area and rubbing over the top. So you just might want, as you go, to sharpen those colours. But this is, as I say, the last layer, so we're now looking at balancing where we might have dulled those colours. So in the darkest parts, while I've got the sepia, I'm just going to go back. Again, this stabbing motion, darken those up. Where else? think that perhaps needs to be a little bit darker. Nearly there. If we come up to the ear area, this just needs to be a tiny bit darker. So these are all the tiny bits now that you're balancing up. I'm just going to put this darkest areas in. Before I put the whites in. Couple of bits down there. That's actually quite dark, so I'm going to use a black there. I'm going to find myself a nice black. That's really quite dark. So this is all about punching out the contrast now in this layer, making sure you've got all the contrasts that are going to make this thing sing before we start to do these really long whiskery bits and hairs on the ears. Of last bits there. Little flicks of dark hair up the top there. Just darken this up. Okay. So we're now ready to get quite brave and put in these long hairs. I say we're quite brave because they're quite long strokes that you want. So it's good, probably good to practice on the ear. But these are hairs that are quite long and in no particular direction really. Let's move some of that pastel. These do flick upwards actually, but you can see they're protecting her ear, so they're quite matted. And again, don't be too precious about the fact that you want to put every individual hair in. You're just trying to get this mass of guard hairs over the top here. You've got a few down here as well. You can see it pushes some of that pastel out of the way. So we're just flicking along there. Tiny little ones that create that little thatch on the side of her ear. I think that's pretty cool. I'm going to add a few in here, just a few that would be highlights, where the light's just picking up the light on there. I think she's got a whisker here. She's also got a big whisker coming down here. So if you're worried about doing whiskers, just pick the odd one or two and get your eye in, and then you can go for the whole lot and be brave and do it all across the mouth. And you can see I'm being quite distinct when I'm doing that. It's almost like a scoop sort of action. So I think we'll do her eyelashes. Call them eyelashes, not eyelashes, are they? What are they? Eyebrows, there we go. So from about here, we're going to go up this way and we're going to be quite definite when we do these whiskers. And you can see immediately when you do this, starts to really look like a cat. She's got a few hairs up here as well. Now don't get too carried away with this, because you'll suddenly find she's all whiskers and you don't really want that. You've got a few stray hairs here. In this ear, she's also got a few. So I'm flicking these. And again, they're not all in the same direction. You can see why we did that base now of dark green. So we've now got a lovely area that we can work on here. And she's got a few eyebrows from the other side. She's got one that's a bit weird there. That's probably more wonky than it needed to be. What you might also notice there is that she's got some dark whiskers. I've already done one here. And I'm using a propelling pencil for this because it's nice and sharp and gives you a really fine line. And you might also just want to tweak a few in there. There we go. You can also, there's a few dark guard hairs that you'll notice in the fur. And as you go over this, as you're finishing, you'll find that a propelling pencil is quite useful. Okay, so before we do those whiskers, I just want to look at this area and the area around her chin. So Schminke white pastel is probably the whitest pastel that I know. Obviously you can get a lot of white pastels, but this is pretty much snow white. So on here, she's got some beautiful white highlights. And when I do this, you might be screaming at me now thinking, "Whoa, it's too much, it's too much." And you'll see exactly what we do to push this back in a second. But you can see it's beautiful powdery white that we've got on here. And it really pushes the rest of this out. And then down here, I've got some powdery white and some little bits along here. You can see it's really powdery because it's dropping off. It's actually falling all over. And then on her bib, she's got some really nice white highlights there. Okay, so that was my pastel. I've got a very fine colour shaper here, clay shaper I'm using. I'm just going to blow away that pastel. I'm just going to blend this in. And you can see now that as we blend it in, it gives you some really nice, almost like clumps of fur. We can blend it into that darker area. And this bit here. Just so that we've got much nicer highlight and she's looking a bit more furry. We do the same up here. Careful not to take too much of it off because you still want this lovely sort of blown highlight effect, where it's really catching the light. Okay, she looks really furry there. So then back to my Caran d'Ache pastel. I have sharpened this with a scalpel so that I can now just pull out the last little hairs on there. If it gets too much, if you put too much white on, you can go back with your propelling pencil. I'm just pushing upwards here and just push those dark low lights back in. Not too bad there. Don't do too much. All about the layers again. Finish that bit. And then down here she's got this little thatch of whites. Do these tiny hairs that come out here. And we're just blending that stick pastel along with some pencil lines. Go back to my stabbing again. And again, I'm going in the, well, pretty much the same direction, but crisscrossing. Fern doesn't lay flat and all sort of, you know, in identical lines to each other. It does crisscross, so you just want to make sure that it looks natural. And on that form there where her jawline is, you remember we put that warm grey, I think that was a pit pastel warm grey that we put in there. That's now given us space to be able to create these longer hairs on top. Fabulous. So for this part, I'm using two pencils I'm using my Caradash white, and I'm also using a Albrecht Dürer watercolour white. And the reason I use this is because it's a very soft wax based pencil. And the two of them are pretty good for creating whiskers because the pastel will create these beautiful, here we go, diffused sort of whiskers. And again, don't be too precious about you know, getting exactly the same whiskers that are on there on your reference, but just make sure she's got enough she can get about with. And again, be quite definite, so just push. You'll see what happens when you put a pastel whisker on. You get this diffused effect. You have to make sure you've got a sharp pastel pencil. Oh, she's all whiskers when you look. You have to be quite brave because you're going over, and this is why I said make sure that you're finished with your mouth as well. You have to be quite brave because you're going to go over that work. All right, I'm going to swap to this watercolour pencil because when you put watercolour whiskers on, they're less diffused. You can get slightly finer whiskers. And that's quite useful for the ones that are closer to you. So again, that one's pretty much a black and white one. Oh, lost my lead there. So I'm just going to put the black on. She's also got a couple more black ones coming out there. Couple more hairs there. Few guard hairs on there, and then I think I'm done with my whiskers. You can tell when you're finished. Well, I can tell when I'm finished because I start faffing around with the rest of the piece. So pretty much done. I think one last little bit. There we go. Last little highlight. I think we'll call her done. So we finished our pastel painting of the wildcat. Let's just recap on how we created that texture. We did the first layer with stick pastels. You remember stick pastels have much more pigment to binder ratio, so it makes them smoother, makes them cover much better, and it's quicker basically to do that base layer of colour. We kept that base layer just a slight tone deeper than the actual colour to give us that colour space to work in. And once we'd created that, we were ready to add some more detail, I guess, into the texture. And we do this with pastel pencils. So on this next layer, and if you look here, there's a good example of this. This is quite a distinctive area of texture. So we created a darker base and we worked into it with lighter pastel pencils. We then added any more depth that had gone missing, because sometimes it can do as you're layering on top of this. We added that back in with a pastel pencil in sepia. And we worked all over the image, paying attention to the direction of the fur and also to the length of fur. So here we've got the medium length. On the ears, we'd obviously got the longer hairs. And over on the snout here and on the muzzle, we got the shorter hairs. So pay attention to the direction and to the length of the hairs. And once we had become happy with the second layer of texture that we put into there, we're ready to do the finishing layer, which we do again with pastel pencils, except for when we get to the whiskers, and then we tend to use watercolour. Just for the last few, so maybe the odd one or two strokes on there with watercolour pencil. And that's it. Beautiful Scottish wildcat in pastel on velour. Thanks for watching.